Berwyn Church last July. Selections from Haydn and Schubert entertained our local residents as well as the tourists in the area. This has become a tradition and makes for a delightful summer Sunday afternoon, and we plan another concert in July this year. The town's commitment to the visual arts is reinforced annually by a purchase of an original artwork at the Labor Day Art Show at Fort Williams. Last September, a watercolor of Marsh with ducks in flight was selected. The artist E. Johnson captured in beauty and energy one of nature's wonders. This watercolor is displayed in Town Hall and complements the wide selection of art depicting life, regions, and characteristics of Maine. Because of our townspeople's varied interests in music, a fall festival was planned for October. Ann Dodson performed traditional, contemporary, and original blues and folk music. Her instrumental work on guitar and mountain dulcimer further delighted her audiences. Ms. Dodson also spent time in our high school in lecture and performance. The music students were exposed to a contemporary Maine artist and the impact of folk music on society during the 20th century. This festival culminated with a concert by Different Shoes, a group of four Maine musicians of which Ann Dodson is a member. December was a time of celebration, so the festival theme continued in Songs of Winter. Pamela Stewart, a solo vocalist, embarked on a musical excursion into the legends and mysteries of this favored season with an emphasis on poetry and music. Insights into many traditions and rituals were presented. In an effort to encourage and honor the creative interest and endeavors of our youth, work of our art students was exhibited at the Thomas Memorial Library once again this past March. We recognize our art educators, Celeste Roberge, Laura Givertz, and Susie Therrien, for their professional direction and sense of excellence. The personal commitment and statement of our young artists gave great merit to this show. As we move with excitement into the spring season, April will be time for a new offering. A bus trip to Boston has been planned. The Boston Museum of Fine Arts will be visited as well as the Science Museum. With the outing occurring during spring break, families will have an opportunity to take advantage of these impressive museums with convenience and ease, and might I mention, the trip is free. This year, the Arts Commission will impact Family Fun Day by co-sponsoring the New England New Vaudeville Review. Skills in juggling, mime, storytelling, and zany characterizations surely will delight audiences both young and old. With an interest in better serving the town, an outside display case noting all activities involving the library and the Arts Commission has been proposed. Terry Norton, a commission member, drafted the design incorporating architectural features from both the old and new buildings. This is to be a collaborative effort involving the high school industrial arts students. And I do have a rendering that Terry Norton did. It's kind of hard to see, but it really is going to be beautiful if we can get it done. And we're hoping to have some plantings around it. And this will be right outside the front doors of the library. Instead of having a lot of notices tacked to the doors, we'll have a nice display case for upcoming events and anything of interest that people should take note of. This will be lighted.
Hold it up a little bit so the council could see it.
Oh, sure. I'm sorry. And I'll be glad to pass it if you like.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Just in ending, cooperative efforts are both exciting and rewarding. Mike McGovern and the people of Cape Elizabeth lend a support vital to the Commission's achievements. We appreciate the enthusiastic responses and participation of our townspeople. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just a minute. Does anybody on the council have a question? Yes, Councilor McLaughlin.
Just curious, to continue to plug the bus trip to Boston, are there any openings left on that? No. Okay.
We filled it in one day.
Wonderful.
So
great.
We know where we have some good interest.
Definitely.
Anybody else? Councilor Masterson.
Are you offering tickets to the Monet exhibit?
No, people will have to take care of that themselves. It's a very large show and it's only ticketed through Ticketron. But we gave enough advance notice that I do believe people should be able to get tickets and go on that day.
I went last week and it was sold out in the middle of the week.
Yeah, well, we hopefully we'll be able to accommodate some people who want to see that show, but it was really kind of up to them to do that.
Anybody else? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next is citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Does anybody out there got something they'd like to bring up that isn't tied to the agenda? If not, we'll move on to reports and correspondence. On the council, have anything? Councilor Emerald.
I just would like to congratulate fellow councilor Nancy Masterton, who was recently confirmed, in fact, last Friday, by the State Senate to be a new member of the University Board of Trustees. Congratulations, Nancy.
Anybody else? Councilor McGlaughlin?
I'll make up for last month.
Yes, do that.
In my position as chair of the council's appointments committee, I'm putting out a plea for one opening that we have right now. There's a vacancy on the Family Fun Day committee. I consider this an emergency, as I said to a person connected with the Cape Courier this morning. It will be advertised in the Courier. The person we're looking for would be responsible for coordinating the children's activities for Family Fun Day. I think all of us know what a very important part of Family Fun Day that is, and hopefully somebody who would be interested would call Town Hall today as soon as possible and let us know of your interest in serving in that capacity. I live on Old Colony Lane and recently received notice that I had a certified letter. We get one of those and go, what's going on? I was very impressed. This was a letter sent by the town informing me that the street was going to be repaved, telling me what days approximately that work would be done. And I know my neighbors were impressed and appreciative of getting that notice from the town. It's a good policy that we have. I'm glad to see that we do things like that. Again, in my capacity as chair of the appointments committee, I want to report that in the past several weeks, the appointments committee has sponsored two orientation meetings. We did one for the orientation of new board and commission members, which was very well attended. We've also done one more recently for a discussion meeting for the chairman of the boards and commissions. And I want to thank Debbie Pizzo and Chairman Bill Jordan and Manager Mike McGovern for helping out with those meetings. They seem to be very well received and hopefully will follow that same kind of meeting in the next year. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Next on the agenda is a public hearing, which is what everyone here is waiting for. This, what we'll do, the chairman of the ordinance committee, Councilor Creeman, will outline some of the changes, and as soon as he finishes that, I will open it up to a public hearing, and anyone that wishes to speak will get a chance to speak. Just try not to repeat what someone has said before you, other than just say I concur or something like that, because we don't want to drag it on for a couple hours or more. Councilor Creeman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As chairman of the ordinance committee, I'd like to report out to you all proposed amendments for the zoning ordinance containing the ordinance committee's recommendations relating to the protection of wetlands in Cape Elizabeth. As you all know, we've had many meetings on this item since it was referred to us several months ago. We have tried very hard to consider all of the public input at the town council hearings and further input since that time. As you know, we have opened all of our ordinance committee deliberations to the public and all have had an opportunity to join us in our deliberations. The Ordinance Committee at this point does want to express its appreciation to many members of the public who have contributed to the process, as well as to our town planner, Steve Butler, who is here this evening, Jerry Daigle, and Ernie McVeigh of our staff, as well as Barbara Ray. All of these people have worked very closely with us to reach the point we're at this evening. As you probably realize, if you had been at the last council meeting, the proposed wetlands provisions are now included in the zoning ordinance itself. This change came about at the request of our code enforcement personnel. Since the current Resource Protection District overlays the proposed critical wetland zones, it was agreed by all that enforcement could be clarified with one set of regulations. Many of the changes since the town council last saw this document and presented it formally to the public are somewhat technical in nature, and that's why we have all of those individuals I mentioned to you already, as well as our town attorney with us this evening. I will go over several of the areas that have seen some substantial changes, but before doing that, I did want to make a note of two particular amendments that we are recommending following our last ordinance committee meeting that was held last week, that was subsequent to the official 79-page document you have before you this evening. They are the following. The first involves section 19.2-8-02. For your help, this is found on page 23 of the large document. At number 9, where several use activities and structures are listed, number 9 is entitled Residential Buildings and Accessory Structures. Before this particular amendment, as had been proposed, was a no in the critical wetland zones and wetland buffers with a special permit in the wetland protection zones. We have amended number 9 to read as follows. The no would be replaced by 5 asterisks. That's only to conform with the system that we've used. Someday we'll probably put a small 5, but for the moment it's going to have 5 asterisks. At number 9, residential building and accessory structures, we're going to change the no under the column headed critical wetland zones and wetland buffers to those 5 asterisks. And then at the end of section 19.2-8-02, we will add in the notes section to explain what those 5 asterisks mean. And they will mean the following: that residential buildings and accessory structures are prohibited in a critical wetland zone and within 100 feet of a critical wetland. In any remaining wetland buffers beyond the 100 feet, that would be the next 150 feet for the full 250-foot buffer, residential buildings and accessory structures are allowed with a special permit granted subject to the provisions of 19-3-9-04. What that essentially means is that as the proposed document tonight was essentially stating that residential buildings and accessory structures would not be allowed at all in that 250-foot buffer area abutting the upland edge of the critical wetland zone, we've essentially lopped off 60% of that area to say that basically the no only involves that first 100 feet. So in a sense, giving back, if you want to talk about gains and nets, giving back 60% of that land area. And so we would not be just taking a plumb line 250 foot from the upland edge of the critical wetland and then planting a stake and saying that everything in that 250-foot zone is sacred and cannot be built upon. We're moving that stake back 150 foot closer to the critical wetland. The second proposed amendment, for your convenience, is found on page 63. It is section 19-3-9-13, and it's been somewhat taken on the title of the inverse setback provision. It's proposed to make section F a new section, section 19-3-9-14, and to title it inverse setback provision and to amend the section as follows. The provisions of section 19-3-9 shall not apply to that area around a main building, which is defined as being a 50-foot horizontal measurement from any part of a residential building, including attachments, extending outward for a distance of 50 feet in any direction without causing crossing within 100 feet of the upland edge of a critical wetland. the dwelling footprint shown upon the assessor's property card as of April 1st, 1990 shall be used to determine the wetland setback. So again, what we're talking about is in a sense a bit of a bubble that would be in a 50-foot concentric circle around the main building, including attachments, that would in essence give one 50 feet to build out into as long as that didn't cross the closest 100 feet of the buffer zone of the upland edge of the critical wetland. Those are the two newest amendments to the major document. Without going through the particular lines, let me just quickly summarize the major changes that have been made since we incorporated the proposed wetland provisions into the zoning ordinance. A new definition of forest management has been included. A new definition of growing season has been included. A definition of pond has been added. A new definition of timber harvesting has been added. The establishment of critical wetland zones and wetland protection zones are now described as formal zones. Special agricultural provisions have been added. A grandfathering of existing ponds has been added. In essence, ponds would have to be registered within 90 days of the effective date of the wetland provisions. Grooming of existing residential lawns and landscaping has been allowed. The incursion of another zone into critical wetland zones is prohibited. This district incursion provision would not apply to critical wetland zones. The map would make the zones only suggestions instead of force of law. And item 157 this evening will be on the map itself. We're going to treat that as a second item after the formal language of the proposed amendments. We are making clear that the buffers apply only to critical wetland zones, not to wetland protection zones. Timber harvesting provisions have been changed. Grandfathering provisions have been added. An exemption has been created around existing homes. And those are the major alterations that we have suggested. As I mentioned a moment ago, we have the town assessor, the town code enforcement officer, our town attorney, and the town planner. I don't pretend to have mastered this document nor memorized all of its provisions, and I will certainly defer to the expertise of these individuals should there be specific questions that I feel unable or not really qualified to take on. Let me only say in closing that the process that we've gone through has tried very hard to listen to any and all input that has been made. I think that we've tried very hard to create a fair and equitable compromise, balancing the importance of landowners' rights as well as the importance of providing fragile areas of the environment. And on that note, I will give back the microphone to the chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Creeman. Very good. Now I'll open it up to a public hearing, and I would like to have you come down to the podium, state your name, and we'll go from there. Who would like to start? Nobody? Yes, sir.
My name's Eric Olson. I live over on Spurwink Avenue. And I have a pond on my property, approximately an acre and a half of open water. And I have a question relating to section 19-2-8-02, item number 21. On the four asterisks where they talk about registering your pond. I'm Just like to know, what is the advantage or disadvantage or purpose of registering a pond? I can't seem to find a definition of that.
Well, essentially, it allows the pond to stay a pond. But I'm going to defer perhaps to Steve Butler. He may be the best person to give a more technical explanation, Mr. Olson.
Steve Butler, town planner. I think the benefit of registering the pond is then there would be no confusion about whether or not it was a pond that was existing at the time of the enactment of the ordinance, so that if it was indeed registered, then you would be allowed to maintain it, keep it in its present form. Otherwise, if you wanted to maintain it at some point in the future, if it wasn't registered, the possibility might occur that it would be treated as a critical wetland instead of as a relatively small pond.
That would mean that you wouldn't be able to alter it or a variety of other...
Right. The other restrictions in the ordinance would apply, so that you wouldn't be able to fill, drain, dredge, excavate, dam. I mean, a lot of existing ponds might be dammed now. In terms of wanting to repair or maintain the dam, that might not be allowed to occur if it was treated as a wetland. But if it's a registered pond, the normal maintenance would be allowed to occur.
Is this part of the state code? Or apparently you've got a different copy than me. Would this be registered with the town or with the state?
Registered with the town. This is a local provision.
Just a local
provision. The intent is to make sure that some pond that already exists today isn't mistakenly covered under this provision. So the idea was that within 90 days of now, there would be a lot of publicity set up and people would be encouraged to register the pond so that no confusion would occur sometime in the future.
Well, I've just been trying to find something in print as to what we would be allowed to do with it. Otherwise, I'm aware of the amount of work that has gone into this. I think you've done a fine job, and I agree with most of it, with the exception of the map, and I guess we'll leave that for the next discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next. Yes.
How you doing? My name's Steve Witten. I own some property along with my brother on Spurwick Avenue, and I haven't had a chance to read over the entire proposed ordinance because I was not notified. Just last month, I was notified by Ernie McVane that this ordinance would basically wipe out the right for us to build on our property. I had talked with Ernie McVane, and he said that the property would be buildable if I conformed to getting a building permit and everything else. So my question is, in the ordinance, I haven't seen any documentation to, as far as the fees. What I'm saying is that if I have a piece of property and I have to get a building permit to prove that it's buildable, to basically, so I still would be able to build after this ordinance takes effect. So I'm saying is, would there possibility of putting an amendment to the ordinance of allowing to a waiver for the fees if you're doing this basically for paperwork purposes. I would not build as of now, but to ensure the right for me to build, I would have to pay a few thousand dollars that I would think that would be unfair as of now to do that if I'm not going to build right at this time and moment.
The manager, do you want to hear?
Currently, if anyone applies for a building permit, the fee goes along with, I believe it's $4 per thousand of valuation, $4,000 of estimated construction value. So if it was a $100,000 home, the fee would be $400.
Along, yeah, but with doing a site plan and the sewer permit, my thing is I don't think that it would be too fair to pay a few thousand dollars to prove to the town that the land is buildable. I mean, Ernie had said that I would give you a letter saying that the land is buildable at this time and point. Okay, but I don't think that it would be fair to, just for paperwork, that I would have to pay that few thousand dollars to prove again, which is only going to be good for 5 months. And I will not be building within the next 5 months. It was basically land that was given to me by my father as my future. And when this goes in effect, that would basically wipe out that right unless I did pay that few thousand dollars. And I just feel that that is kind of, I mean, I'm for the ordinance of the conservation aspect of it, but I feel that there should be some sort of a waiver put in that if, you know, if you're not going to build right of way, but if you already have the right as of now, that you shouldn't just, you know, take it away.
Okay. Councilor Creamer, you will add a...
The plan right now, maybe the town assessor can respond to the particular issue of the fees, but basically there will be certain situations in terms of building that if these amendments went into effect this evening, there would be a 30-day period of time whereby a building permit would have to be submitted to the town. Is that correct as of if these provisions went through? Jerry? Please. I think that'd be helpful for everyone.
Jerry Daigle, the town assessor. I'm not sure if I understand what you're asking. The permit fee would remain the same now as it would if the ordinance would pass. It is not unusual when applying for a building permit to come in, fill out the application, show evidence that you are able to connect to the public sewer, and also meet the setbacks. That would not change. We have no real way of knowing if a lot is buildable until that takes place. And until such time as a permit application is made and a set of plans is presented to us and all these other things that I just mentioned, we really can't tell if the lot is buildable or not buildable. So I think the instructions were to, sorry, I forgot your name.
Steve.
The instructions, Steve, were that, in essence, if he were to now file for the building permit, he could, in fact, beat some of the provisions that are coming down with this new wetland ordinance. And I think in order for him to do that, he's going to have to file in the normal manner, which is paying the fees and verifying that he can, in fact, build on the lot. I don't know if that answers your question.
Well, it answers my question, but again, there would be a time restraint in terms of 30 days from the enactment of these proposed amendments. Isn't that correct?
That's true. That would be 30 days. If it were adopted tonight, it would be you would have, in fact, 30 days to produce the paperwork necessary to apply for permit. I'm not sure of that.
Yeah, I understand that.
We haven't built a waiver into the system as a as an opportunity to defer those fees, if that's the bottom line.
That's basically what I'm trying to get across, that I understand that the whole process of obtaining a building permit that has been shown to me by Ernie McVain, but the whole purpose is that I don't plan on building on the property, and I wish to have that right to build on it at a future time, but I don't feel that right now to beat this ordinance I would have to pay a few thousand dollars to do that. I mean, I just, you know, because I'm not going to build. When you get a building permit, that means you're going to build a house or whatever structure you want to build. It's going to take effect. But for as paperwork purposes, I don't feel that I should have to have all that fees paid. I understand that they could probably look at it. I'm not saying I'm going to pay not anything, but I feel that there should be some sort of a reduced fee or something to get it to that point where they can determine whether it is buildable or not buildable. That's the only thing I have to say.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Yes? Okay, all yours.
Richard Davis, Spurwink Avenue. And through the chairman, I'd like to ask Mr. Creelman a question about the two recent amendments. The 19-2-802, to me, seems to contradict with, on page 53,
19.3906, wetland buffers. Is that wetland buffer still in that section I just read? Because if it is, then that says the criteria is a 250-foot buffer will be required if a wetland area meets one of the following criteria. And so then there's one, two, three, four, there's five different items there. So if that's still in effect, I mean, to me, it contradicts the amendment, because if you meet any one of those five, then you're required to have a 250-foot buffer. And then you go to the amendment, and then the amendment, which isn't to that section, it's an entirely different section. It says that 100 feet, you can't build in a critical, and the next 150, you have to go through a procedure. And my other question, Mr. Creelman, is the criteria is set up for the 250, and then you go to the criteria for a 100-foot buffer. And the 100 says, if you meet one of the following, and there's two there. Now, supposing someone meets all of the five for the 250, and they meet one for the 100, what happens then?
Well, let me respond to the first, because the intent is that everything you say is true on your reading of page 53 and following in terms of the criteria for 250-foot buffer. We are specifically and in this place only, or I should say within these two places only, with the two amendments, changing the criteria from the 250 to 100 feet, simply in order for residential building to take place in a not as restricted area. So that is the intent. If the language, that's how I want you to understand it anyway, as the exception. If it's an issue of language, then I need to defer to the town attorney, because what we have done is to try to create language that would not make that confusing in that one instance with the five asterisk on number nine.
I understand what you're trying to do, and I think it's a good effort, but I think that's very confusing. And I think it's particularly confusing when you have a criteria of five items for a 250-foot buffer, and if a party, I mean, assuming a party meets four of those but doesn't meet one, they can't build within the 250 feet. And then you drop down into the 100-foot buffer, and if you meet, you know, one of those, and then you're only subject to 100. I mean, it seems to me that what you've tried to do is good, but I think you've got to incorporate it a little differently, or maybe delete, you know, some of this other language in here. That's my view on it. I mean, it just seems, notwithstanding the amendment, I mean, when you come out and apply for a permit and you have someone go through this and you meet the criteria for a 250, and then you could go to 100 and maybe not meet one of those. It seems like they're contradictory to me.
Yes. Our town attorney will see if he can straighten that out.
Chairman Tom Lee, I don't know if I'll straighten it out, but I think the way I would look at it is the criteria of what you look to establish a 250-foot buffer. And that's town-wide in regard to all wetlands or around critical wetlands. The proposed amendment, the first proposed amendment, deals with a specific use. You have, I think, 26 different uses in section 19.2802. There are 26. In regard to one, residential use, there's a curtailment of that buffer. It's an amendment. It lessens what the impact is, but it doesn't change it. We have criteria, and then in regard to a particular use, we're going to allow something in that buffer. I don't find it inconsistent. I mean, I think, in other words, town-wide, you've established where the 250-foot buffers are. And then in regard to this particular use, residential use, you said, however, we'll allow an incursion into that buffer within the limits set forth in the amendment. So I think one's criteria for establishing buffers, the other one is a particular use, one of 26, where in that particular case there's a different standard, if you will. So there's a different impact. I don't think they're consistent. I don't think they're inconsistent. In regard to the second question raised by Mr. Davis, I believe when the committee was reviewing what the appropriate criteria would be for the 250-foot buffer, it found that all five of these were solid criteria. In other words, if any one were met, then the buffer would apply. So I think if we just stop there, we can say that that makes sense. If any one of the following five are met, then the buffer applies. The fact that a lesser buffer only applies in more limited cases, the two being if you're close to a densely populated area or if you're distinctly separate from any other wetlands, I mean, I can see those and live with those. And if, again, I don't have a problem with, I don't find that inconsistent with having five criteria, any one of which would be met for a 250-foot buffer. So, again, I don't necessarily find them inconsistent. I think the problem I'm having a bit is determining whether under Mr. Davis's facts you're going to have a particular property that falls under both, that there's an overlap. Is that what you're concerned?
Yeah, that was my question. You could have one, for example, where you would meet all five for the 250, and you would also meet one of the two for 100.
And you have the 250. If you meet any, I think if but you meet any of the criteria for a 250-foot buffer, then you're in a 250-foot.
But
I think that would apply.
But it doesn't say that, you know, for the 100. It says if you meet one of the following, it's a 100-foot buffer.
Do you feel, Tom, that maybe some language needs to be changed there to clarify it for somebody in the, anybody interpreting in the future?
Well, I wish we had a few minutes to think about this.
Okay.
Maybe I can review
well,
it a little further with Mr. Davis or this evening while this goes on. This hasn't been raised before to my knowledge, and I'll be glad to get back to you in a few minutes to see if we could add a sentence that says, to make them mutually exclusive. I think his point is that they should be mutually exclusive. The language is not there to make them mutually exclusive. So his question is which one applies if they're both applicable.
Councilor Creamer, did you have something?
Well, the only thing that I thought I could have helped by clearing up was that although if you met one of the criteria, one of the five for the 250-foot buffer, but you were dealing with number nine, we have exempted those five criteria in a sense and sort of given over the opportunity to take the 100-foot as the sacred spot and then move beyond that and then with a special permit from the planning board to build only in the number nine situation. All the rest of them would still apply and follow with exactly how you've explained it.
Yeah, that's all, excuse me, Tom. That's all I had, but you know, that has been confusing. In fact, I was at a prior meeting before the council when that was brought up, and there was a difference of opinion, and it hasn't been changed since. I really think that's one point that you could clarify.
Or if we all understand it to be the way we're explaining it, Tom, maybe if you can do your legalese thing while we're going on with other input and perhaps get a mutually acceptable syntactical way of describing this to make it clearer.
Anybody else? Yes.
My name is Peter Rumry. I live on Papuduk Drive. And thank you for your time. You have spent a tremendous amount of time on this wetlands ordinance, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you on this. I was pleased to have a copy of both the proposed ordinance change and the wetlands map early enough so that I could try to digest it over a period of time. The proposed wetland map is equally as valuable as a wetlands ordinance. As a matter of fact, it may be considered more important in that it is a wetlands map that decides what areas all this zoning and wetlands change takes place, the permissions, the restrictions of which particular areas. I can't speak about areas of the map that I'm not familiar with, but the 8.5 acres that bounds my deed and some surrounding area is grossly incorrect in my opinion. I'm not a botanist, but rather an engineer who has some familiarity with maps. This map has a legend which indicates wetland vegetation by circles of a diameter something greater than, I thought it was 140 feet. I measured it today, and those appear to be about 170 feet. Now, the area inside 170 foot is about a half an acre. My house lot is 10,000 square feet, and there appears to be a circle almost absolutely in the center of my square lot. I'm positive there's no wetland on my lot, and I doubt there is any wetland vegetation, unless a botanist might consider some of the plants that my wife has indoors, and I don't mean to be flip with that remark. Is the circle symbol for areas that have predominant wetland vegetation?
Are you asking a question?
Yes, I'm asking a question, and I have a few.
Yes, at the moment, my understanding is that it is. And the only thing I'm just going to ask, and I'm sure this is all pertinent to item 156, but the map itself is the next item, and I suppose we can...
I think we've got to discuss both of them as we go along.
Okay.
I don't see how you're going to stay from one to the other and tie the on, even though we vote separately.
I think you're right, Mr. Chairman. And of course, the intent was that we would try to do it that way, only to solve some of the technical difficulties that you are well elucidating, and Mr. Clough has well elucidated in a letter to me, as has others. What we are basically, let me just sort of steal the thunder a bit if I can find my page, and I can't find it right now, but with item 157, we're going to propose that we accept this map, which is, I'm embarrassed to say, Star Wars ahead of the Mylar map we had 4 months ago for the town's perusal on this same easel. And we are going to propose adding all of the subdivisions, tightening up the map, and presenting it again to the council, I believe roughly October 1990, for full approval, recognizing that the map is going to be an important document. I think a lot of people will get lost in some of the wording in the wetlands provisions themselves, and it's a lot easier to go to a map and say, aha, there's my lot, but it says a pond is on top of my house. How come it says that? Obviously, that's embarrassing. We haven't done the kind of fine-tuning that we would like to do, which is why the map will only be a suggestion. It is not force of law, and it won't be that with respect to interpreting these wetland regulations. It will only be suggested. And I can't underscore that enough, and you can say, well, your map ought to be tighter and it ought not to have these flaws in it, and I totally agree. That map will never be perfect. Mother Nature won't allow it to be, but I can promise that we're going to try to do a whole lot better by October of 1990. I don't know what more I can say to the map.
Do you want to add something?
Just other than that, in addressing your specific concern about the circles, when the map came back from the map maker, we all agreed the circles were inappropriate, and the scale was considerably off. And as we look to develop a new map in the future, we're going to look at something other than circles of that size.
Okay.
Yes and no. I understand what you're saying, and I'm glad to hear you say that you're aware that the map needs a lot of work. However, between now and October is quite a period of time, and there may be people who would like to do things with their land, and they are considered to be in a wetland area by this map, which drives the initiation of your zoning, special permits, etc.
No, I would have to disagree, because it's always subject to field verification.
That is true. As I read it, there may be a difference of opinion between the people that look at it, whether they are the experts, the botanists that may or may not be registered or whatever, the soil scientists that don't like to work for nothing. The way I read the ordinance, the expense for this correction, if you will, of where a wetland is or is not, is borne by the landowner. In other words, to tell the town really where the wetland is on the landowner's land.
Well, that's not entirely true. I think, Jerry, we'll have situations where, again, if there's an obvious disagreement, you're both walking to the top of the hill, and it's obvious that there is no wetlands there, despite what it says on the map, my understanding is that we are not going to require a variety of experts to determine that. Is that correct? Please. It's easier, I think, for the people and the public to hear if you get behind the microphone.
With the field man, is that what you're up to?
I believe you're basically right. I think in the office, where we can determine where the edge of the critical wetland is, we can do so. We may be able to do so by going on the site and making a visit. I think there's going to come the time, though, when there will be an issue where wetland may exist, and we're, speaking for Ernie, we're not always experts on what might be under our feet. And I think those are the times that are going to be a little tough in the next 6 months. So I'm answering by saying, yes, we will, and there are times when we won't be able to, and I'm not sure if Mr. Romney falls in that or not.
This is one thing that we've wrestled with ever since a map has come out, and ever since we worked with the ordinance and the map. And there's got to be a period here that I think there's got to be some give and take to it, one way or the other.
What bothers me about it, I guess, is if we adopt the ordinance and the language as I hear tonight, we would be, I guess, forced to administer with the map as good or as bad as it is for the next 6 months. So we're going to make some mistakes, and I'm not sure if Mr. Rummery will be kind to us making those mistakes.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Masterson.
Ernie, doesn't the ordinance...
I mean Jerry.
Doesn't the ordinance permit the town to hire outside expertise to help in situations where there is a disagreement between the landowner and the town?
You mean for the town to hire?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not...
Mm-hmm.
Is there, okay, I guess I'm be given...
There is a provision in there.
Okay, I guess I'm not familiar with it. To the point where we would, I'm not sure at what point we would institute that. I guess I'd have to defer to Mike if.
Yes, there is a provision that the code enforcement officer can solicit outside expertise, and in addition to that, funds are provided in the draft budget that's been given to the council for that purpose.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Peter, you got another? Question,
yes,
are you satisfied?
Just a little
you're
more,
not
Bill.
Satisfied, I understand by your look.
I would like to think that the town would bear that expense, and I cannot stand here now and tell you the exact page that I read that indicated that there would be a fund set up. In the absence of that fund, the landowner's permit fee would be used. My understanding from that, and it may be negative because... where I'm coming from, my understanding was that would be borne by the landowner as opposed to the town. And if you say the determination of the wetland correction compared to what's shown on the map would be borne by the town, It's just a little of my tax money shared with everybody else, other than me paying the whole thing.
Thank you. You want to add something to that?
Yeah, you know, where the town funds will come in would be in areas of dispute, areas of doubt. We're not going to go out and do wetland studies for everyone's lot. You know, we're going to ask people with the coming in with applicants to provide us with some data and with some to have done some work at their own expense. The town's funds will be used more for verification and in areas of doubt. But you know, the funds aren't unlimited, and we just can't do a wetland study for every piece of land that someone wants looked at.
Thank you.
Okay.
If I can take a little more.
Okay, go ahead.
Here again, when this map is corrected, there's an intermittent stream shown crossing Spurwink Avenue, and I make it to be out of position by about 700 or 800 feet. There's presently very near my property a 30-inch culvert, which the Department of Transportation changed about 18 years ago, and it doesn't even show, and the crossing of this stream appears about 700 feet south. I don't understand why the map has not been upgraded in this length of time.
Well, okay. It has been, and unfortunately, you point out an obvious problem if indeed this area hasn't been updated in 18 years. What we have asked for each time we've dealt with the map as a legal document, and we've actually tried to make that less of a legal document and only using it as a suggestion, is that if any of the citizens who have come in to view the map, and there have been many over the last several weeks, if there are specific areas on the map that are problematic, please let us know. That's the only way we are going to update the map as tightly as possible. The staff has recommended that we adopt the map this evening as an interim map, and they are requesting that a revised map be presented at our October 1990 meeting. That October date isn't anything etched in granite that can be changed. But again, all of the subdivisions as of July 1st, 1990, all updated wetlands information would be included as part of that updated map. And then, per the ordinance, all of those updating procedures would be taking place in regular fashion. So the map will be an evolving tool for the town staff to use in the determination of wetlands. It will never be a static photo. It'll always be evolving, and at some points I suspect it will be less helpful as a tool than others.
Okay.
All right. I'd like you to consider your line 2533 in section 19-3-9-02. This is paragraph D under that. That general subject is areas where these particular regulations apply, wetlands. It states that there are areas otherwise subject to this ordinance are not exempt from its provisions due to the placement of fill material thereon, regardless of when such fill material was deposited. Very technically, I think that means forever. And I don't know whether by filling you mean something that happened 10 years ago, 40 years ago. Your definition of filling at the beginning of this document, which is on line number 220, talks about filling as any movement of the topsoil, and I'm paraphrasing. There's been farming going on here for ever since the Jordans have been here, which is a lot longer than the Rumreys. That's movement of topsoil, and supposedly if there was wetland underneath that, it appears to me to be a very difficult paragraph to deal with, to administer.
I think it is. Many months ago, didn't you make the point it was really about 1630 that we started our problem with fill in Cape Elizabeth when the first settlers came?
No, it wasn't It wasn't myself.
Someone made that point, but I think, you know, the point's been well taken that determining when and if and how and to what elevation fill has taken place, that's going to be a very, very difficult situation. I think we left that in because I think we are aware of some obvious problems associated with fill. And maybe your point is that we ought to somehow grandfather fill or something along those lines. I think it hangs all right the way it is right now. Steve, or anyone want to try to address the point that Mr. Rumry is making? I don't have a problem with D as it stands. I think it's just a philosophical argument you can have all night about when fill is fill and, you know, when it started. But please.
I guess all I have to say, I agree. I mean, I think it's an issue that was debated by the ordinance committee, I think by the council at one or two of its workshops before. And it's pretty much stated the way it is. And there are some instances I know that the council thought of as examples for which it wanted to keep that in, at least in previous meetings.
Well, isn't, just a minute, Steve, but isn't it going to make it confusing for somebody that wants to do something or interpreting this ordinance? How's it going to be interpreted?
I think that's more a question for the code enforcement people.
Than well, we'll bring them up.
My name is Ernie McVane, code officer. What we'd have to determine is what the original soil type was. This would probably involve a soil scientist.
Soil what?
Scientist. At that point, if it was determined that it was fill placed over a wetland, then it would come under the special permit procedures if it was a permitted use. If it was able to demonstrate that the original soil was not of a wetland type soil, then there wouldn't be any problem at all.
Okay, thank you. Does that clear it up for you?
I'm afraid it does. 40 years ago, at any rate, consider please line 2699 in section 19-3-903, paragraph N. This is the section dealing with submission requirements for a special permit. This paragraph gives the town planner the right to require whatever studies, reports, or submissions he desires before a permit be issued. You will notice this is the 14th item of an already long list of requirements. No offense to Steve Butler, but why does the town planner have this much power? I could see the time that there could be, well, I'll leave it there.
I don't think it is an issue of giving the town planner any real additional power. I think the town planner works at behest of the town and works in conjunction with the planning board. And I think there's a fluid motion back and forth to what the planning board and the planner do with respect to requirements for these particular submissions. So I think we've left it relatively open in that the town planner may require additional information at the suggestion or encouragement of the planning board.
You see, I think it should be the reverse. My understanding is that the town planner helps the planning board. I'm not sure, I don't know whether he's an elected official, an appointed official, but this verbiage gives him the right to himself require certain stipulations or submissions. I would think if I read your meaning, that that should be changed to the planning board.
Steve, can you help him out on that? I mean, aren't you getting the information together for the planning board, or can you require more information than the planning board will need? You're the author of this document. I want the people to understand.
I'm sorry, but I beg to differ. That's not true, Mr. Chairman, at all. And let me say very clearly that the town planner does not set town policy, nor does the town attorney. Town policy is set by the town council.
Okay. There have been many drafters, and people have gotten little bits in here. I think the 2 points, I guess, that I'd like to make. One is that I do serve the planning board. That's in my role as town planner. That's, I view, one of my major responsibilities. However, what the planning board has been looking for more and more is for the town planner to take over a lot of the administrative details. And if there's something obvious that from their comments needs to be added, that's something that would be added here. I guess the other point I would like to bring out is that there is the provision for the planning board to waive one or more of the following conditions. So that if for some reason the town planner, myself, or somebody in the future were getting out of line, the planning board could always step in and say, we're waiving that final provision. I think it's just something that when I'm looking at an application, if there's something obvious that needs to be added to make the material pertinent to the situation at hand, that section gives me, as the administrative staff to the planning board, the ability to ask for it.
So therefore, if somebody's going for the planning board and you feel that would be something the planning board will require, you can ask him to do it at that point. Otherwise, it might go before the board, and the board would ask him to do the same thing. So
right.
In a sense, it is going to help the
right.
person that's going before the planning board.
We're trying to get a head start on it. And a lot of times that happens now where it's up to the board. I suggest that it might be something that the board's going to require. The applicant decides to take his or her chance and wait, and they end up delaying things by a month. So,
thank you. All set?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank
Anybody
you.
Else? Yes, sir.
My name's Thomas M. Egan. I live on Hannaford Cove Road. I've had a chance to read the proposed ordinance, and I think it's a fine document. I'm sure there are going to be problems over the years if the council adopts it, but it shows to me that there has been an incredible amount of work that was put into this. There's good science in this law, as well as good drafting, so I wanted to make that comment first. I have a question that goes to the distinction, which was just raised actually, between the circles and the designations critical wetland versus wetland protection. My question is the difference, does the difference lie in the fact that with respect to the circled areas, the onus of proving the area to be wetland lies on the neighbors as opposed to having the owner of that land disprove that it is wetland? See what I'm saying? In the critical wetland area, the owner of the property, according to the zoning law, it seems, must prove to the satisfaction of the building inspector that the land is not wetland or critical wetland. The same is true of the wetland protection area. The onus lies on the owner of the property to prove that it is not deserving of protection. But with respect to these little circles, it seems to me that the designation is meaningless because the owner of the property has no onus there to prove that the land is not wetland. The onus would lie upon the neighbors, for example, who felt, as in our case down in this neighborhood, that this group of circles, which is in a swale feeding into that pond at the end of Hannaford Cove Road, is deserving of significant wetland protection. So is that the difference between the circle and the other protected zones? My criticism, I have a going on after I've asked that question now. My criticism of the ordinance is that it does not seem to provide a mechanism for neighbors to have a particular area of importance to the neighborhood designated as deserving of wetland protection. I don't see, for example, an appeal process such as the appeal process for a subsurface wastewater disposal system, which is I think a fine part of the ordinance, which I, by the way, used last year. I think that the ordinance is defective in that respect, because the neighbors who are seeing a building or development going on a particular lot that is not in the zone, where do they get their, what kind of power do they have to bring to a halt, if you will, the construction at that point? Those are my two questions.
Well, it might be easier to respond. Well, maybe I'll respond to your first question. Tom, do you want to do the circles, or do you want to do? Okay, do the second one then. Go ahead. Please come to the microphone.
Try to get the language of the other change resolved, and I think I do. And so I missed the discussion of the circles. The second one, there is no appeal provision or rights to the general public to appeal these determinations. That was discussed at a particular period of time, I believe at the ordinance committee level. The answer, I guess, is it's up to the appointed codes enforcement officer to go out and enforce this code and the other codes. That we went through the steps of what happens when somebody wonders if he's got wetlands and he goes before and he tries to convince the code enforcement officer, I don't have wetlands. We've talked about that. If in doubt, it goes to the planning board. The planning board makes a determination with the advice of the Conservation Commission. And I assume the neighborhood, who may feel that a given property or a given location is a wetland or should be in a wetland buffer, would have an opportunity at either of those levels to speak up and indicate why the evidence before the planning board for determination is, should support the finding of a wetland, a critical wetland or a buffer.
But Tom, you're assuming that the issue is before the planning board. If you are in a circle area, you're not at the planning board. You are at you're before the code enforcement officer only.
Well, I think the answer is that presumably people could go to court if they thought an ordinance, perhaps they go to court if they thought the ordinance was being violated. But I think there'd be a special permit application filed, or if there's not and the action takes place, then I suspect those neighbors would call the town and say, something is occurring without a permit, and we think a permit's required because that's a wetland area. And then the town would be tipped off that something's occurring, then could go out and make an inspection and make a determination whether or not it's a wetland area that requires a permit. And if so, issue a stop work order and tell the person to come before the planning board to get a permit.
That's right. And we have invested in the code enforcement officer basically the authority to do exactly that. What we felt as a policy-making decision was that if we allowed for appeal by really any citizen in Cape Elizabeth seeing a building going on, saying, my heavens, you shouldn't be doing that, we've got to stop that, one could then just line up at town hall and provide a series of complaints and formal stop work orders such that the person could never finish their particular structure unless we put some sort of limit. So what we've said instead is that any citizen who sees something that they feel ought not to be happening, they should go to town hall and get our code enforcement officer out there immediately.
All right, well, let me give you an example of how that doesn't work. On a lot next door to mine, which I subsequently purchased after going through a rather lengthy process, an individual had obtained a permit for a subsurface wastewater disposal system. And the whole neighborhood said, gee, that's on the ledge. We've got to get that stopped. And we went to Ernie and we said to Ernie, gee, that shouldn't happen. But Ernie and the Board of Zoning Appeals rightfully said they had no jurisdiction to stop the construction at that point because there was no appeal process. So the town council, thanks to Mr. Latore, passed an ordinance which provided to an aggrieved abutter, let's say, the opportunity to take an appeal from a subsurface wastewater disposal system permit. And I took one of those last year, and it turned out that the system failed and had to be moved, you know, 50 feet or something like that. Now, in this case, if someone were building in a zone that has a circle where there's wetland vegetation, and there's a judgment call as to whether it's predominantly wetland vegetation and therefore wetlands, the building inspector will make that determination, but unless the citizens have some input in the process, if they think he made a mistake, the citizens don't have any recourse other than to go to court, I guess.
Councilor Coggeshall.
If you're referring to the issuance of a building permit, is that what your example?
The example is a building permit in the circle area where someone might believe that there's wetland to be protected.
Right.
For the benefit of the whole neighborhood.
If the code enforcement officer had issued a building permit, isn't there a 30-day appeal period anyway?
Yes, from the issuance of the permit.
And this is still under the zoning ordinance, so that within 30 days, if you do not agree with the decision of the code enforcement officer, you can issue an appeal and have it go before the zoning board.
Now, if does that mean the zoning board has cognizance of questions involving whether or not a certain area is wetland or not? Do you see what I'm saying?
Using the map as a guide?
Yeah, using the map or taking testimony and so on. I mean,
have to have your professionals come in and verify.
So in other words, in addition to the planning board having cognizance over wetland questions, the zoning board of appeals would as well.
Since it's under the zoning ordinance, it could be.
It's new to all of us, but I think it probably
would. Okay. Yeah, they would have to be familiar with this document.
Okay. All right. Well, then the last question I have is, and you're doing very well answering these. The last question I have is there any process which the citizenry could use to suggest to whoever is mapping out these areas that certain areas should be designated critical wetland or wetland protection? Is there any process for that?
The process is, if it's critical, we're going to have a judgment made with respect to it being moderate or high value wetland area.
Go ahead. Just a minute.
That is exactly the intent of having this period until October, is for the opportunity for anyone who has any points one way or the other, should be wetland or should not be wetland, to provide some substantive information, some analytical data to show that the map is wrong or is right.
Mike, how would someone who does not own property, how would the abutters of the property that the abutters believe should be designated wetland protection or critical wetland develop the scientific criteria that could be placed before the planning board to establish whether or not it should be critical wetland or wetland protection?
In that instance, you know, obviously you don't have the right to trespass onto someone else's property
right.
or test it. But, you know, if you see an area of wetland vegetation that falls under the definition of wetland vegetation in this ordinance, you'd bring it to the attention of the building inspector. He would go look at it and make a judgment, and, you know, that would be it. Again, you know, even when the map is adopted, readopted 6 months ago, if that should happen 6 months from now, as far as I've heard from the ordinance committee, the intent is still for the map to be suggestive only. It's a guide, particularly so with these circles. They have even less force than the wetland protection zones and the critical wetlands.
I think the circles, whatever they turn out to be, dots or circle, no, they won't be dots because that's wetland protection. I conceptually, I have a problem with the circle areas. But once again, I think you've done a great job with a very tough subject. It's It's convoluted, it's fraught with conflict, but there's good science in this, and I want to thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
My name is Joan French, and I live at 21 Eastfield Road. I'd like to do a little bit follow-up on what this gentleman prior to me was talking about. Again, this is a lot of hard work went into this, and I think the spirit of the zoning is very good. The problem that I think causes confusion for people may be that when an area is subject to the building inspector to go out to see whether or not it's, as you say, the map is a guide, it's not a set in concrete. When the building inspector does go out to review an area, are the neighbors or abutting property owners notified of that, and do they have any input upon it? Because a decision could be made for which and the neighbors don't even know about it, or abutting property owners, who an abutting property owner might be very much affected, that water that exists could then spill onto his property. And yet, at the time of the change, he was not notified of it all, so that you don't have any exchange of ideas or explanations. So I think that's a bit of a flaw on that, and there is no mechanism within here so that a person can do that. The other feeling is that a lot of times wetlands can be very deceiving. The wetland season really starts in February and is in full bloom from March right on through the end of May. If you go on a piece of property in the months of July and August, you can be very much deceived. There may be wetland vegetation, but it's difficult to determine whether it's really a very critical area or just a place that happens to have some wetland vegetation. One very good example is right on Eastfield Road. And in fact, I notice on your map, you have it as the, not the critical, but the wetland protection on Eastfield itself. And that area from February, end of February, until the 1st of June is a good 3 feet underwater. If you go out there in July, but it drains off so that by July and August, it's wet or mucky, but it's not wet. And so you would never understand if someone were to go out there and take a look, they would not realize that, and it starts filling up in November, that you've got a lot of water to deal with. So I guess I would request that you would restrict in this that wetland areas could not be reviewed in the months of July and August, only because it's very difficult to determine how much water is involved. It's very much like dealing with tidal zones. You can't review how much the high tide has effect until you actually see the high tide when it comes up. So that would be the same effect here. It does concern us very much when neighbors aren't notified. A good example is that a house was granted a building permit. You say that there's an appeal process within 30 days. In our neighborhood, on Lot 30, a building permit was issued, but no one knew about it until 3 months later. When the neighborhood made a request to appeal, we were told the 30 days was up, and that was that. There was no mechanism for us to, and that was prior to any construction being done. And that house actually has had a tremendous effect. That lot was also involved in another zoning board decision, and many members of the zoning board stated that it was rather questionable that a permit should have been given there. It was totally ringed by wetlands. But the permit was given, and that was the fact. The effect of that house has been rather dramatic in that area. The lot next to it, the water level, as I say, is a good 3 feet right now, and it drains 24 hours a day, but it's still 3 feet deep. And it spills out onto the street, and our rainfall is 3 inches less than normal this year. So we have seen a displacement of the water, that the water has been displaced into that lot and the lots next to it, and it goes into the street, and yet there's still more fill that will be put on that lot. So we haven't even seen the full effect of that lot being developed. So it, would there be any opportunity to put into this a mechanism for neighborhood input or abutter input?
Joe, let me respond to the standing water issue first, in that I think I hear what you say, and I certainly know the area well that you're talking about. Standing water, or at least where the substrate is saturated with water, has been restricted to 20 consecutive days in the growing season as one of four criteria to determine a wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
So unfortunately, I think there are going to be lands that are wet at some parts of the year, and then there are going to be wetlands that will satisfy one of these four criteria, and they may not always be the same land. The second point about the abutters is, and I don't want to sound hyperbolic, but Jerry, please come up. Our concern was that if we created a mechanism for citizen input every time the code enforcement officer went out to render an opinion, of which, you know, Cape Elizabeth pays him to do this, and as technical and precise and successful way as possible, it would simply paralyze the code enforcement officer from really being able to do the job that he has to do. And this is why, quite honestly, after putting so much time in these amendments, we place the entire wetland protection section within the zoning ordinance, because it really is currently Ernie and Jerry who are responsible for enforcing the zoning ordinance. So unless I'm speaking somewhere differently, the issue of notifying the people involved that certainly have a vested interest, our concern was that it would just absolutely paralyze the office in terms of getting anything done. Ernie, Jerry, please.
Yes, you're right. The process now is that we have no real mechanism to notify people, abutters, and I understand their feeling, because there have been times when we wish we could have, you know, maybe notified, especially in those troublesome areas where there are wetlands, and we know that it's a concern of the citizenry. But unless it is a zoning board appeal, we have no real way of notifying the neighbors. It is not a total secret, though, that something is going to be taking place on the lot. I must admit that usually there is some surveying, there are some people walking around, and I think sometimes neighbors are pretty sharp about this, because we get calls sometimes way in advance of something like this going on. But to answer your question, I really don't know of a way to handle this any other way than we're doing now.
Thank you. You have another question?
Well, my only concern, though, is that by not a neighbor not being able to know, or an abutting property, he can be severely affected by that. For example, right now, I mean, that's not a major problem with us, but I can't, when there are major rainstorms, there is so much water that floods out onto our street right now that it's impossible to get to the mail at all. I mean, it's just there's a lake in front of there. There's a property at the end of Eastfield, I mean, at the end of your wetland protection, for which water now is going onto it. Now, I'm talking about one lot, that it's a third of an acre, that is, the entire lot is 3 feet underwater, a good 3 feet underwater. That water is going to go somewhere. That can go right onto that person's property. And yet, that person who has been there, or that house that has been there for a good 25 years, will not know that a permit has been given. And in all honesty, when that permit was given for the lot on Lot 30, there was absolutely no knowledge. And I don't think, just as the town hall does not want to be paralyzed notifying the neighbors, I don't think the town hall also wants to be paralyzed by phone calls. You know, is there a permit out? It doesn't, you know, you can always request for the person requesting the permit to notify surrounding people and pay for the stamps and $5 for typing up the letter. That way, and build that in as part of the permit fee. Because someone, if they have a piece of property and it's valued at, let's say, $150,000, and now they have the yard flooded, has lost out in the mechanism to have a say, and yet they have a very much a vested interest in the change of a designation of a wetland.
Okay, thank you. I think the town attorney is, he can add a little something to that.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to point out that the penalties for violation are quite severe. So considering the comments that we just made, we're assuming someone has a wetland or is proposing an activity that would be in violation of the ordinance. In that case, the penalties for violation are $1,000 each day that it continues. The town can go to court and get a restraining order and can call for the restoration of that property. I think that $1,000 a day would be a deterrent, and it's a much more significant deterrent than your old ordinance. I point that out, meaning to show that I think someone who may have a question as to whether he's in a wetland or not ought to go to the code enforcement officer and say, come on out and take a look. And I think what this provides is a mechanism for that code enforcement officer to go and have expert opinion obtained at town expense as provided to help him out. I'm not saying that there's not something to be gained by having input by other parties. This isn't in a vacuum. And if someone goes out and violates this, there are substantial penalties. And so if they proceed cautiously, it will be through a mechanism through the town process.
But Tom, she's talking about challenging the code enforcement officer's decision, some mechanism that the townspeople can use to challenge the decision, similar to, as Tom Egan mentioned, the way we can challenge the subsurface disposal systems. The same argument could have been used about when we drafted that ordinance, that it was going to, quote unquote, paralyze the system if citizens have the input to challenge. It hasn't paralyzed the system, nor would this, unless people were frivolously challenging at every drop of the hat, which would be a waste of their time and money. If it's clearly not wet, we're talking about very highly debatable wetlands areas, the same as with the subsurface disposal system, very highly debatable. No one's going to waste their time and hard-earned money hiring these experts unless it's a real close call. And that's what I think a very interesting point's been unearthed here, which could bear further discussion as the night wears on.
I don't disagree. The standard the code enforcement officer is supposed to use, if there's a reasonable doubt, which is almost like the criminal standard, if there's a reasonable doubt of whether it's a wetland or not, then it has to go up. So that and the penalties, I think, would indicate that people should be very cautious, and the code enforcement officer should be very cautious in permitting an activity to continue or making determinations of where the boundary lines are.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin.
I've got a question. I don't know if it's better for which of the town staff to answer, but to help me better understand some of the comments being made, I would like to know how long a building permit is good for. Is it good for a certain amount of time to substantial construction or what?
Building permit is issued, once issued, it's good for 30 days, okay? To answer some of the concerns that I'm hearing is the existing ordinance doesn't have any provision for filled land. And the area that that is of concern is a filled lot. The new ordinance, proposed ordinance, addresses fill.
Yeah.
Okay? So there's a substantial difference right there.
So presumably in the lot being discussed right now, a permit may not have been issued, or more investigation may have taken place.
Without directing any thoughts towards that particular lot, I would just say in general, any lot that is filled today, if there are wetlands below the fill, if it's a permitted use, then it will be a review process by the planning board under these provisions.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I think you misspoke, Ernie.
Okay.
A building permit is appealable for 30 days, but a permit extends beyond 30 days.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. You can appeal it within 30 days of the date of issuance, and it's good for 5 months.
Five months, you have to begin work?
You must have substantial construction within 5 months.
Must be started, yeah.
You've got to start within 5 months.
So it's possible to get your building permit, wait 31 days, simply just have no trucks go out there. I mean, be very cool about your surveyors and the way they do their thing so that they don't alert the neighbors.
So they beat the system.
And wait 31 days.
Right, absolutely.
Very, very easy to beat
absolutely.
The system.
And what I have done, and every time someone writes me a letter requesting information on a certain lot, if there's no information on that lot, then I take that letter and I attach it to a folder and I start a folder for that lot. So when something does come in, I do notify the people. That's the only way I have of handling it. I do try to get the information out if they request it, and that's, I find, the easiest way for me to do it. I don't have to do it, but I find that it helps me, and it just works a whole lot easier.
Thank you.
I just have one final request, and that is, since tonight you are saying that this goes into effect and it is the only guide, as a resident of Eastfield, and I think I speak for the other residents in Eastfield, that area that does exist right after the CW zone is considered wetland protection. And we would like to request that that be considered a critical wetland only because of the sheer volume of water that exists in there. I think it would be a waste of both the planning board, zoning board, town council's time if they had to deal with special permits all the time. But we request that a review be for that area and it be changed to a critical wetland. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Just a minute, Mr. Perry. Okay, come on. You're fine. Is this Kenneth or Robert?
Well, I was going to say that if anybody read the paper and they know that fella, I'd like to meet him because I think we've got a few things in common. This is Kenneth right here this evening. But first of all, I want to say I appreciate the work of these people that have really worked so long. I can't say I agree with an awful lot of it, but I can recognize an awful lot of hours put into it that I wouldn't have wanted to have had to put myself to. First of all, I want you to know that I'm in favor of protecting not only wetlands, but all lands in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I disagree quite strongly with the attitude that wetlands are the only lands worth saving. I don't want to destroy the wetlands, but I look at all the lands, the uplands, the highlands, the level lands, the farming land, the whole of it, as being very, very valuable, and I think we're missing that point quite strongly. I look at land a little different than most of us. Most of us look for land for a home, for roads for travel, place to work, place to shop, and we all look for a place to have recreation or open space and these type of things. But from my roots, even to today, I look at land quite a lot different than that. A land where I can make a living, land where I can look for the good farming soil. If I see a lot that I might be able to purchase, it's got upland and highland and hills and ledge and rocks and also wetlands. I look at the whole picture to see how I can use that in farming. Certainly, I'm not going to dig an irrigation pond up on top of the hill. I've got to put that down in the wetland. I've put in quite a lot of drains from these type of areas to drain the marginal lands as far as moisture. And then I've also had to do an awful lot of irrigation up on the hills and the dry land. It's all together in one picture. And so I look at land as a whole total picture, and I don't separate one from the other. And in agriculture, we need to have all of these available to us. Now, if I had the privilege of being in some farming area where you see that nice level land just disappear in the future, right out of sight, that's different, but in Maine, we don't have that privilege. We have the rolling hills and the uplands and the wetlands, and we have to take it all together in a package. So some of the things I've thought and will probably express in my comments will come from that direction, shall we say. I find out that I'm blessed with a black dot on my property way up here in the corner. That's quite a good size one, according to them. I've been thinking of how I can narrow it down so it won't come be a black dot anymore. But this is in back of my house on the corner of Spillink Avenue, where I have all my farming operation located. People are amazed when they drive down a driveway and they see greenhouses and tractor sheds and coolers and repair shops and things, all part of a farm enterprise. that they never dreamed were there. Well, every structure that I have, except my residence, is within 50 feet, 100 feet of that black dot, and some, most of them are closer than that. I created that somewhat, and my father did, although it was possibly there before then. There's a marsh or wetland, but we bulldozed it out, made a nice skating pond, and a pond for the kids to play with, and using that soil to grade up around the edges, I'll put my greenhouses within 30 or 40 feet, perhaps, or even closer from the pond. And to me, it's worked quite well. I need more storage for some of these expensive equipment that I'm buying, but I cannot build another building in that area at all. I believe I'm restricted now to the 250 feet as far as agricultural buildings, not residential. So I've got to go clear up beyond that pond, way up into the woods. I sometimes wonder if the best spot would be 25 feet from the Canterbury Hills condominiums, but that's too far away from me to make it practical, and that wouldn't be good either. I have appreciated stopping out to the town hall and getting standing between Mr. Daigle and Mr. McVane a few times, trying to update myself as to some of these amendments and the latest things. And every once in a while, Mr. Butler will wander through. And it's interesting as to the comments that we hear, the yeses and the noes and the maybes, that I'm still getting. So, as I've heard tonight, this is a tremendous document that no one here is prepared to say they understand it. And this thought here of that pond, how it affects my farm enterprise, even the lie, you got 400 feet on the road, how does it affect that? Is it still developable, isn't it? 250 feet goes right up across Spillink Avenue, right to the other side of the road, if we're restricted to that. So there's a lot of questions that I don't have the answers to. And I certainly can't say, well, God bless you, go ahead, vote for it tonight with my blessing, because there's just too many questions that are unanswered. I can continue my farming operation there in that area, the way I understand it, but I cannot make any changes. I cannot add a building or anything unless I go with outside of the 250-foot area, which Todd Spillink would be on the other side of the road. The other way would be clear back up in the woods. Just to make one, I don't want to be facetious, but you know you've been through about 24 drafts, and that's been painful to you far more than it has for me. But, you know, I've got to think that someone on the committee here thought that the 10th draft was the perfect one, or the 15th, or the 18th, or the 19th. But you still keep it going, looking for it, and I congratulate for the courage of keeping going. But how many more have we got to go? The way I understand it, there's no one here that has a completely updated copy with your amendments. Now, maybe the council has, I don't know. But every time I come here, I'm about four drafts behind, if you see what I mean. And this is not your fault, but it does relate to the complicated thing that we're working on. First of all, in sort of closing, I'd just like to remind you that this ordinance is going to hurt the most, the people in town that have done the most to protect this open space and wetlands that you want to protect now. This is why I want to encourage you to be careful and cautious. If I had have sold everything in the town in 1985 and gone who knows where, you know, that would have been the place to go. I could have sold it to a developer or whatever it is, but I don't want to do that. I want this land to be saved, not for open space necessarily, although I enjoy it, but I'm hoping that I will be able to maintain my farm in the future. By the way, it's May 17th is the opening of the market, okay? How's that? How's that? Lord willing. So,
any other plugs?
No. I'm just trying to see what I... just to comment quickly on the map, you said it's a guide. That's all I'm ever going to accept it as, is a guide, nothing else. The highest spot in my Dyer field there between Spillink and Sawyer is in wetland protections. The highest hill in the middle of it they get a dot on the corner of the Spillane Medical Building property that's either their lawn or the upper end of my field. I challenge you to find a wetland plant growing there. If you find one, I'll take care of that immediately, but anyway, you know, so I realize that it is strictly a guide. But I do have one concern, and it has to what we have heard here. I don't mind if you move into Cape Elizabeth, build a house on a little lot, put a fence around it, throw your stuff across the fence onto my property, whatever it is, I can handle it. But when I get the feeling that you're looking at me so that when I try to do what you have done with the idea that you don't want me to have that privilege, it bothers me a little bit. And that's the one thing I'm concerned about the map. I've got dots all over my property, and that does one thing, and that alerts everybody to the fact that that's a wetland protection area. That allows me to watch you. That allows me to call up the chairman and say, hey, you know what's planning on? Now, that's not completely wrong, but where are our property rights? I hope that we're not going to develop to a place to where the citizens, the neighbors, are going to have the control of my property or your property. I hope we can develop expertise here that's right and fair with our people here, Jerry Daigle and the others, so that they will make the decision. I had a neighbor across the street of my new market that was disappointed to think that that was going in there. That was very costly to me, okay? Very expensive to me. She's back in Texas, far as I know, so that's behind me. But that's if the neighbors have the right. If I have the right, that's wrong. I want to be able to come to the town here and have experts tell me convincingly, this is, this isn't. This is right, it can, or it can't be. I hope that I won't have to be the one to choose whether you can do something on your property. This is my concern that what that map will do. All I can say is, I know it's been too long, but I'd say, hey, I don't like the idea of adopting this for now, knowing you're going to change it. I'd say there's no hurry. The only hurry there is, if you think there's a development coming in you want to, hey, let's forget about that. Let's get this map. I'll get this ordinance and get it the best we can. I can't think of anything else to say, and so I thank you for the privilege of letting me share it with you.
Mr. Maxwell, let me just make a comment or two, because I think that myself personally, and I think the entire council has really done everything possible to perhaps do just the opposite in terms of encouraging agriculture. We have set agriculture up. Certainly existing uses are entirely exempted. We have created a special section with respect to new agricultural activities, indicating that we're using a 75-foot buffer zone abutting the critical wetland zones area. And I think the new comprehensive plan that we spent an evening last night, last week, the town council and the comprehensive planning commission, very clearly encourages and respects and realizes that agricultural issues and farming are why many of us have chosen to live in Cape Elizabeth. The last thing this document intends to do is to infringe upon your rights and your desire to continue farming. I think the last thing we want you to do is to sell your land and move away somewhere. We don't want that. At the same time, I think there's always going to be an honest difference of opinion as to what's valuable and what perhaps isn't that valuable. And that's where we've tried very hard to, through soils, through hydrology, through the best efforts we can, and in the most technical way, to make some kind of value judgment regarding that. As I say, I hope it's been a fair approach, but I also think there is a point in time where, not because in any sense of the word we are tired of redoing this ordinance, because if there was something egregious about the ordinance, I don't think any of us would have a problem doing that. But I think that the ordinance has come to a point of being fair, and like any ordinance, I think you have to try to use the ordinance. If you find that it's not fair, then you amend it. This is true of the packet that this ordinance is going to, if voted into existence tonight, be placed in. There are amendments throughout the zoning ordinances where we find, as policymakers, that something doesn't fit, or it isn't right, or it isn't entirely fair, and then we do our best to change that. I only say that in some kind of response because I know how strongly you feel about what you've said this evening.
Well, I appreciate that, and I don't want to feel as though I'm the only one here who knows the challenges of agriculture or those type of things, and I'm on one side and everybody else is on the other side across the track, shall we say. But I'll certainly try to live with this however it comes. There won't be any nighttime activities, shall we say, to try to go around it. But if this ordinance was in effect 30 years ago, that land between Spillink and Sawyer would either be trees or development. Because to do the drainage ditching and those type of thing in wetland areas, see, that I had to do with this, I don't see what would be possible. Now, maybe it's, you know, maybe it is. Maybe there's technicalities there that I don't understand. But I just want you to draw that out, that the things that made that a beautiful farming area, I don't believe would have been possible under this. The Trout Brook, you know, for instance. That's a brook that we want to protect. Well, you know, I've got a big irrigation pond right in the middle of Trout Brook, you know. And now I can continue that as current activities. But to extend it, do more, as far as I know, that's out. This is what I've got to face in the future. Now, that doesn't mean you haven't worked your hardest to try to come to a compromise. But I'm still concerned of those things. Not necessarily for me, but for the next generation, which I hope will want to continue. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Perry.